Rick Revel, Mr. History, brought to you in part by Dixie Gunworks in Union City, Tennessee. As a musician and singer, I've played and sung Sweet Home Alabama dozens of times. And every time I hear it on the radio, I crank it up. Lynyrd Skynyrd made musical history with that song, and so did the studio and the town where it was recorded. There's a lot of history in Muscle Shoals and Florence, Alabama, and I'm going to share a small portion with you today. As soon as I get freshened up a bit and get my clothes changed, we'll get this show started. And what a better place to do it than the birthplace of W.C. Handy. Since our first show, topics on History Highway have ranged from the Revolutionary War to the Vietnam War, and many subjects in between. But in this episode, I'm going to indulge myself, and I'm going to talk about one of my true loves, and that's music. Before I tell you the W.C. Handy story, let's bop over to where Fame Studios set up shop for the first time. As a recording artist, I've spent a lot of time in Nashville, which allowed me to cross paths with Billy Sherrill, who used to produce George Jones and Tammy Wynette at Epic Records. Today I'm in Florence, Alabama, where he and Rick Hall and Tom Stafford started Fame Recording Studios and created a whole new sound. In 1959, Billy, Rick, and Tom called their business Florence, Alabama Music Enterprises, or better known as Fame Recording and Publishing Company. They were first located above the city drugstore at the intersection of Seminary and Tennessee Streets. In the early 1960s, Hall split from Sherrill and Stafford and moved into an old tobacco warehouse on Wilson Down Road in Muscle Shoals. It would be in that studio where he'd cut his first hit song, Arthur Alexander's You Better Move On. Money from that chartbuster allowed Hall to build a new studio on Avalon Avenue in Muscle Shoals. The first hit produced in that studio was Steal Away by Jimmy Hughes, and music history was being made once again. Rick Hall was obviously white and lived in the Deep South, and the majority of the artists he produced were people of color. In a time when civil rights issues were at their hottest, the Muscle Shoals music scene was setting an example for the rest of the country to follow. One story worth telling is when the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin, came to Fame Studios to capture that unique sound she was after. Much to her surprise, not only was Rick Hall white, so were most of the musicians on the session. Two of the Muscle Shoals horns were white, and the entire Muscle Shoals rhythm section was too. The Muscle Shoals rhythm section eventually became known as the Swampers when they left Fame Studios and started their own called the Muscle Shoals Sound. In that group was one of my heroes, Jimmy Johnson. who was not only an incredible guitarist, but he was the producer who helped record Sweet Home Alabama. In our next segment, we're going to jump to the Alabama Hall of Fame in Tuscumbia, where we're going to learn more about the Swampers and some of the other great talent from the state of Alabama. It doesn't matter if you're a reenactor who loves the smell of black powder in the morning on the battlefield, or a collector who admires the craftsmanship of a well-made weapon of old. Dixie Gunworks has a Pedersoli just for you. And not only does Dixie Gunworks have a warehouse full of Pedersoli reproduction firearms, they have an incredible collection of antique firearms. Inside the pages of their huge catalog, you will find gun parts, shooting accessories, reenactor clothing, camping supplies, and even some big guns if you like to burn a lot of powder. Dixie Gun Works is located in Union City, Tennessee. But for your convenience, visit our online store at www.dixiegunworks.com or call 1-800-238-6785.
The Chevy Silverado Trail Boss. When you have a 2-inch lift, when you have Goodyear DuraTrack tires, when you have Rancho shocks and an integrated dual exhaust, when you have all that, the last thing you'll need is a road. The Chevy Silverado Trail Boss, ready to off-road, right from the factory.
It's gonna get hot today. Grab an ice cold sun drop and show us how you drop it.
Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot.
And drop it.
Cause I got it going on. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot.
A thirst quenching citrus soda just dropped coast to coast. Sun drop.
That's how you drop it.
Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot.
The state of Alabama has so many talented entertainers, they had to build a Hall of Fame just to celebrate their greatness. Follow me inside as we take a quick look at the musicians and singers that actually called Sweet Home Alabama their home. As promised, we're on the inside of the Hall of Fame here at Tuscumbia, Alabama. Here with John Mosley, and he's kind of got like, he's a curator of the museum and Hall of Fame, and he's going to kind of give us a quick synopsis, a tour of what's here to see.
Sure, absolutely. So I guess I should start, you know, a lot of people ask why this museum is here. Mm-hmm. This is actually where all the music happened, pretty much for the whole state. Mm-hmm. You know, there's Birmingham, there's Montgomery, there's Mobile, but this little area up here just kind of beat them to the punch.
Right.
You know, with their connections and, you know, the talent here was good enough, and the producers here were good enough, and so when it came time in the mid-80s, they were trying to figure out a place to do something like this, to have an official recognition for all the music achievers. They picked this area because, like I said, this was the industrial center for recording. I mean, at one time, there were a dozen studios here in this little Quad City area, which is...
It was the hot spot.
Right.
This was the place to be, and judging by the portraits on the wall in the Hall of Fame, mm-hmm. here, it's amazing. I mean, Hank Sr., and you got it right down the line here,
right.
All the famous people that were here.
Yeah, just about everybody. I mean, there's always people that are waiting to get in, to be inducted, but we... You know, we do about 4 or 5 inductions every other year, and we're always looking for more people to add in. So
that's an amazing thing.
Yeah.
Now, as curator, what's some of the exciting things that you see come through here that you? It's kind of like the you get to reveal the new things.
Right.
So what's the most exciting you've had a part of?
Well, it's like you said. I mean, the exhibits are quite a bit of fun to work on. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't know what you're going to be dealing with. You're always trying to think outside of the box. And so, you know, we're doing some interactive stuff right now that should be done in a couple months. You know, probably the most favorite showcase I've ever worked on was a Grammy Award winner showcase. Ooh, we did awesome. That probably about 4 years ago. That was a really big deal. We had Sam Phillips' son Jerry here and a bunch of Grammy Award winners from the North Alabama area came for that unveiling. Aside from the exhibits and stuff, I always do the group tours as well. And, we get people from all over the world. Of course, that's slowed down a little bit over the past couple of years.
Yes.
But still, we get people all over the world and school groups, all ages, just everybody you can imagine coming here from just about everywhere. So
if you want to come and learn about the music culture of Alabama, this is the place to be, right?
That is correct. There's a lot of other attractions in the area. These studios, like I mentioned, we had a dozen here. This is different from those because you get a kind of a cross-section of everything from the state.
Mm-hmm.
Those museums are really about, what happened there, that somebody, Bob Seger recorded right here, or Aretha
right.
Franklin recorded right here, but here we've got the whole collection,
mm-hmm.
So you can absolutely make a whole day trip down here mm-hmm. and have something to do throughout the day.
And the whole collection, because I mentioned Hank Sr., which that's old traditional country. Then there's Jimmy Rogers, which takes it back to the folk country. Then in the corner up here is Jimmy Johnson of the Swampers.
Right.
Total different type of music, so the collection's enormous. And then you got all the R&B guys, you got Rick Hall, you got Sam Phillips, you got all these cool people here. I can't wait to see the rest of the displays. We're gonna kinda mosey our way through the displays. And
okay.
John, I appreciate your time. I hope
Absolutely.
That people will come see the Alabama Hall of Fame. Believe it or not, when I was 19 years old, I was on his TV show in Birmingham, Alabama, the Country Boy Eddie Show. And to find his display here, wow, this is so cool. That's him.
It's amazing how many times the Swampers and Jimmy Johnson are mentioned in the Hall of Fame. Regretfully, I never got to meet my hero before he died. But thanks to a friend, John Thompson, he introduced me to Jimmy Johnson's wife, Becky, who gave me an invitation to her and Jimmy's home in Sheffield. The home overlooks the Tennessee River, the same river that the Cherokee, Chickasaw, and Creek Indians called the Singing River. Ironically, the states of Tennessee and Alabama are among the most prolific states in the Union when it comes to music production.
I guess what I want to ask more than anything is, how did the name Swampers that he was associated with and that group, because in the music world, Aretha Franklin and a lot of your groups, they all wanted to come to Muscle Shoals and cut their music and wanted to meet this group of black guys that's really cranking out the music, and they get here and it's a bunch of white guys.
Yeah.
And Jimmy's one of them.
That's right. And the artist said, well, they look like grocery store carryouts.
And one of them was at one time.
And they were, yes. One was.
Yes.
But they learned real fast that the Swampers knew what they were doing. And actually how the name originated was from Sweet Home Alabama. The last verse says, and Muscle Shoals has the Swampers.
Mm-hmm.
And it stuck.
One of my all-time favorites, Lynyrd Skynyrd, and he produced Lynyrd Skynyrd and captured that sound, didn't he? Kind of took a honky-tonk band
and made
right.
them what they were.
Right. The story is that Skinner came into town.
Gotcha.
And he went to Jimmy. That's who he wanted.
Right.
And Jimmy was totally booked for 2 or 3 days.
Right.
He couldn't even get him in to listen to him. So Jimmy took him down the street and got them to record him.
Right.
And after they did, after the day was over, Jimmy went down there and paid him $300 for recording him. And then he goes back and he listens to him. And he says, I've got to do this band. I've got to do this band. So that was the beginning.
Coming up in our next segment, Miss Becky will take me over to where Jimmy spent 27 years of his life making musical history.
Ancestry.com searches the world's largest online family history resource so you can discover who you came from. And now it's possible to learn your ethnicity with Ancestry DNA. A simple test will tell you your ethnic origins, where your ancestors lived up to 1,000 years ago, and connect you with relatives you didn't know you had. So now there's even more ways to discover, well, you. Go to AncestryDNA.com to order your kit today.
Good Major, I have often said that it's history that gives us hope, and without that hope, I fear our nation will be extinguished. And we must preserve our history and our heritage. And through our writing, we have tried to do so. One of our books is called Appalachian Rebels. It's by Richard G. Brown and myself, Dave Chaltis, and you can find them on Amazon.com.
Appalachian Rebels is a compelling story of the 5th Kentucky Infantry that became the 10th Kentucky Mounted Rifles and later the 13th Kentucky Cavalry. Get your copy of Appalachian Rebels today at Amazon.com.
Burger or grilled cheese?
Grilled cheese.
Burger.
I went with crispy tenders and the tots. It's patty.
Really fresh. I'm going to try to chow this thing down before I get to the wrapper.
Sonic Wacky Pack.
This is the way chicken was meant to be right here. Fried and crispy.
Y'all never cooked us grilled chicken.
Nah, I didn't know what grilled chicken was like until I probably got 30 years old.
Sonic Chicken Slinger.
Some good chicken.
At 1000 Alabama Avenue in Sheffield, Alabama, Jimmy opened the second home to Muscle Shoals Sound Studios. It is now called the Cypress Moon Studios and owned by Tanya Holly, who is friends with Miss Becky. Joining us on this excursion also is my good friend, John Thompson. It's hard to imagine the hundreds of musicians and recording artists who have roamed these halls and occupied this building. It's actually a who's who's list. Artists like Bob Dylan, Billy Vera, Joe Cocker, Helen Reddy, and the Oak Ridge Boys, just to name a few. Muscle Shoals Sound, nothing like it. The whole show, the whole premise of me doing this show was to talk about the origin of the sound that came out of Muscle Shoals, Alabama. Of course, we talked earlier about the Fame Studio in the show, earlier in the episode, and that kind of was the catalyst that got it started. But where it erupted, where the volcano really erupted, and where it came to life was here. In this studio for 20 plus years, 25 years, 27 years, I think is what I was told, that they actually did it out of the studio. Now this console is not the exact console, but it's where the console set. And this is where Jimmy Johnson worked. And I have Miss Becky Johnson with me today, her husband, who's no longer with us in the physical form, but in spirit, and Lord have mercy, in music, he is still with us. Cannot turn the radio on and not hear a song that he produced, engineered,
or was a musician on
That's
it.
That's right.
His
That's
guitar right. playing, phenomenal. So, you know, here we are, Miss Becky. You know, this was his workshop.
It was. This is where Jimmy did most of his famous stuff, his famous recordings. He always spoke so highly of this studio and how he preferred cutting everybody here. And you can see why. But he loved the studio. He loved the location because Jimmy loved the water. And yes, he did. And this was just his pride and joy. And early on, we had psychops down here. And Jimmy would play. And of course, I was his number one admirer back then. And we occasionally got to dance. Most of the time we didn't, but that was okay too. But this is where it all started, and this is where it all ended.
Well, and you know, we were out there looking at the different album covers that were cut here.
Yes.
And the Billy Vera album cover was sitting out there, and oh, you told me this story, and it's so cool. It's like, here's a song that becomes the one that strokes those heartstrings, becomes one of your favorites, and you had no idea it's cut here.
Never.
And cut by your fellow man. You got your
you
hubby.
You got that. You got that.
So tell me just briefly, I know we've talked about it in another show, but I would love for our viewers to hear this portion
of
the story.
Well, when I made it back to Shoals, and Jimmy and I met up again, we were going down Montgomery Avenue, and I said, Jimmy, you know my favorite song? And he said, honey, what was that? And I said, Jimmy, you know the song by Billy Vera, At This Moment? And if anybody knows Jimmy, they know, they can see him doing this. He slammed on the brakes, and he turned and looked at me. And he said, honey, did you not know I did that? And I said, no, I didn't know that. And I didn't. Right. And there was so much. I was in Nashville for 40 years, and there was so much that Jimmy accomplished, and I did not know it. I do not know it.
And it's hard to believe. It's such an honor that you allowed, you know, introduced me to the individuals that own the studio now so I could come here and spend a little time with one of where my hero worked. Where, you know, Jimmy was a grand engineer, and I always had that bug in me to be an engineer and a producer and to be in the room where he created
yes.
it.
Yes.
It's an amazing thing.
Well, we certainly welcome you here.
Well, thank you, sweetheart.
And Jimmy would love to be here, I'm sure.
I would love to meet him, yes.
I appreciate you coming.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. We'll be right back on the History Highway.
Here? Now. Here. Now. Here.
In the middle of nowhere is somewhere. The all-new Chevy Trailblazer.
Out here, each new day is an opportunity to enjoy what's around you, to take pride in your land, to fire up reasons to be together, to collect new memories, and grow in fresh ways. You live life out here to the fullest. So, in more than 1,900 communities, we're here with everything you need to bring on the new day and with the services that make shopping easier than ever. Tractor Supply, everything you need for life out here.
Hi, I'm Rick Revel, and I'm here today at the Jesse James Riding Stables, home of the Outlaw Cave, the hideout of Jesse James.
Legend has it that Jesse and his gang hid out in this cave after robbing a stagecoach at Mammoth Cave. If you would like to visit his hideout and ride a horse over the trails where the outlaws rode, come to the Jesse James Riding Stable at 3057 Mammoth Cave Road, Cave City, Kentucky. See you there.
The son of a preacher man, W.C. Handy went from singing hallelujah to singing the blues. Although he didn't create the music genre, he did earn the title, the father of the blues.
Born in Florence, Alabama in 1873, William Christopher Handy was told by his father that musical instruments were tools of the devil. Good thing he didn't listen to his father on that piece of advice, or the world would be without some extraordinary music that came from an extraordinary man. In honor of W.C. Handy and the music legend he left behind, I wrote a song I'd like to share with you now, and it's titled, The Father of the Blues.
Trumpet in his hand, oh God. He was a music loving man. Yeah, W.C. Handy, the leader of the band. His preacher daddy would always say, the devil's in that music you play. But he played it anyway. Yeah, W.C. Handy, there's gonna be hell to pay. He fell in love, he changed his world. When he wed that Kentucky girl, oh Lord. Just keep on playing the blues. Picking cotton, picking the blues, kicking the dust off his wore-out shoes. Oh Lord, he's gotta just pace and do. Heaven's gate, before it walked through, St. Peter shouted, we've been waiting for you, oh Lord. The angel band needs somebody new. Yeah, W.C. Handy is in heaven playing the blues. The blue.